Good morning. I am Marsha Berzon. I am a judge on the Ninth Circuit in San Francisco, and I am here to welcome you to the Supreme Court review section of the program this morning. This program is presented by the Education Committee of the Ninth Circuit. This is our only other major task other than presenting the Article III judges meeting, which occurred in Tucson in January. This year, as you may know, we do not have Kathleen Sullivan sitting up here. We also don't have Erwin Chemerinsky or Paul Clement or any other luminary of the academic or litigating bar, because we decided that we could do this very well ourselves. We have a surfeit of constitutional scholars on our court, and we thought that you would like to hear from them for a change. So that's how we're going to do the presentation this morning. The three people who are going to do the presenting are Jay Bybee, who has taught constitutional law and now teaches religion and the law at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, and John Owens, who is recently on the Ninth Circuit, who was a law clerk on the Supreme Court for Justice Ginsburg, and Paul Watford, also recently on the court, who was also relatively recently a law clerk on the Supreme Court for Justice Ginsburg. So with that experience with the court and with the subjects that the court deals with, we are hoping that we will have, and we know we will have, an illuminating conversation. Now, one caveat, of course, is that the court, even though it does about half of what it produced when I was a law clerk to Justice Brennan in 1974-75, still produces enough work each year that we really can't talk about it in an hour and a half. So we have made, hopefully, sensible decisions about both the large cases, which everyone wants to hear about, and some particular areas that particularly impact judges on a daily basis. Those were our main criteria, and I'm sure we will miss some of your favorite cases, but we did the best we can. So with that, Judge Bybee is going to begin with some overall statistics and ruminations about the court term, and then each of the panel members is going to speak about various cases. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Judge Berzon. Good morning. It's very nice to be with you. I'm honored to be a part of this distinguished panel to talk about the Supreme Court's term. By any measure, this was a blockbuster term. We could have only had one case if it had been Obergefell, and it would have been a blockbuster term. But there turns out there were a number of other very important opinions this term, and I want to give you a little bit of a statistical overview of the court's term. So let's see. The court decided 76 opinions this past term. That's about average. It's still down from where the court was in the early 1980s. As late as the 1980s, the court still had a docket of about 150 opinions per term. For the last 20 years, the court has been around 75 to 85 opinions each term. So we had 76 opinions. There were only 66 signed opinions. And the distribution of those opinions tends to be pretty consistent over time. This would be managed largely by the Chief Justice. If the Chief Justice, of course, is not in the majority, then the opportunity of assigning the opinion goes to the most senior justice in the majority. But they try to equalize this out. So you can see that Justice Scalia wrote more majority opinions at 9. Justice Kennedy wrote the fewest at 6. It's a difference of 3. It's a marginal difference there. So you can see that that's fairly even. Where we start to see some differences is when we start looking at other opinions. So here are the concurring opinions. And you can see that all of a sudden we have certain justices who are a lot more chatty than others. And this is sort of the chatty index, because these after all are justices who are concurring in the majority opinion. They didn't have to say anything, they chose to say so. This is sort of the chatty index. The dissenting opinions is really quite significant, and I think it's more dramatic this term than we have seen in past terms. So if you'll take a look, you'll notice that Justice Ginsburg only wrote one dissent in the entire term. Justice Thomas wrote 19. Now, that difference is a very, very stark difference. In fact, Justice Thomas wrote, who wrote 19 opinions, if you look at the left side of the court, the liberal side of the court, that's going to be Justices Ginsburg, Breyer, Sotomayor, and Kagan, those four, they wrote 13 dissenting opinions total, which means that Justices Alito, Scalia, and Thomas each wrote as many or more dissenting opinions than the four justices on the left. That tells us something. It's a snapshot. It's not everything, but it does tell us something about the term. So here's total opinion authorship, and I'll give you the total opinions here in just a minute because I think that's a little bit more interesting. So let's go to the next slide. So these are the total number of opinions written, and I've reordered the court from the least. So Justice Kagan wrote the fewest opinions, only 11. That is less than four opinions per clerk. Justice Thomas. Well, as judges, I knew that you would appreciate that kind of distribution of work. If you clerk for Justice Thomas, you're going to get about 9 opinions. You're going to be working very hard. But notice how it skews to the right side of the court. The big gap occurs between Breyer and Scalia. So everything is fairly even there. That includes Roberts and Kennedy. And the four liberals go from 11 to 16, not a significant difference. All of a sudden, it jumps between Breyer and Scalia from 16 to 28, and then we go 28, 30, and 37. So we've got Scalia, Alito, and Thomas who are, you know, clearly unhappy about things in a big sense. Here's the voting in the majority. So. You want to be careful about these statistics, but it tells us that Justice Breyer voted 72 times. Now that may include some recusals. That's why some of these numbers aren't the same. And voted 66 times, 66 of the 72 cases that he voted on, he voted with majority, meaning that he was in the majority 92% of the time. Sotomayor, 89%, really it's not much of a difference. Kennedy, 88, Ginsburg, 86, Kagan, 85. Then we drop off just a little bit between Kagan and Roberts. Now, again, we've just covered the left side of the court. So Roberts all of a sudden drops to 80, and then we end up with some significant drops here. Alito to 72, Scalia 69, Thomas only 61% of the time. So the difference between Breyer and Thomas is 31%. It's one third, and that is a pretty significant drop. Here's a time chart on voting over time. Don't pay too much attention to the colors. All it's trying to do is just give us a shot of how the left side of the court has voted in the majority over time, and you can see where that trend is going. Here's the right. So there's the right side of the court showing a fairly significant drop off this term. Now, I know the New York Times has run quite a bit on the question of whether the court took a hard left turn this time. I don't think that one term makes a Supreme Court, so I think it's too early to predict that. But I think it does bear out that there was a leftward drift in this term, and that may tell us something. Here's the 5-4 alignments of the court. We had 19 cases decided by a vote of 5-4. Justice Kennedy voting with the liberals decided 8 of those cases. Justice Kennedy voting with the conservatives decided 5 of those cases. The rest are fairly evenly distributed. I did my own addition here just this morning. That means that Justice Kennedy voted with the majority in 5-4 cases 14 out of 19 times. Justice Breyer 13 out of 19. Justice Sotomayor 12 out of 19. So it tells us something. If you are concerned about the Ninth Circuit, you needn't. We had a smashing success this time. we were reversed in 63% of the cases. It's a great record. Go us. I've never put a lot of stock in this, but it's something that court watchers always watch for. I don't know what you can predict here. You know, the Second Circuit had 100% reversal rate. They lost 1 out of 1. So doesn't show you very much. Now, there's one more point I want to take before I turn the microphone over to Judge Owens. There's one other sociological development that we ought to be aware of with the court. I think it's very important, and I'm going to let the headline from Bloomberg News tell you about this development at the court. Supreme Court justices are getting grumpier, study finds. Turns out that two computer science professors at Dartmouth and a law professor at the University of Virginia have authored a study. It was posted on SSRN. It is forthcoming in 2016 in the Washington University Law Review, one that you will want to be watching and go to your newsstand to acquire. But they've done a word analysis of every Supreme Court opinion from the beginning of the Republic and have analyzed it. They went to rhetoricians and analyzed it for certain words that indicate what Justice Frankfurter used to refer to as the mood of the justices. I was very skeptical when I pulled this up off of SSRN as to whether we really could tell anything from this. And after looking at this, so this is taken from this, you can see that we've got some hard science going on here, scatter graphs. And this kind of methodology is not to be questioned. By which I mean it's not to be questioned by me because I don't understand it. But it looks pretty authoritative. So. They then ranked all of the justices. Justice Kagan, we didn't have enough information on, but they ranked all of the justices, 107 justices of the United States, according to their friendliness. I'm going to give you a partial listing. So here's the friendliness index from number 1 to 107. Number 1, the friendliest justice ever to sit on the court, was the first justice appointed, the Chief Justice John Jay. Ellsworth, Baldwin, the Chases, Samuel, and Salmon are the next ones in there, and you can see that we're down to the hundredth place in terms of percentages. I included other prominent justices on here. So John Marshall comes in at number 32 with a minus 0.16 friendliness index. Justice McReynolds, I'm going to come back to Justice McReynolds in a minute and tell you why I included him, is at number 51. The first modern justice to show up at number 56 is Justice Ginsburg. The Chief Justice comes in at number 75. Justice O'Connor, bless her heart, comes in at 95. It just seems incomprehensible, but this is science. You know, you can't argue with science. Number 98 was Justice Scalia, and here are the bottom six. Justice Rehnquist, Kennedy, Thomas, Breyer, number 106, Samuel Alito, and number 107, the least friendly justice ever to sit on the Supreme Court, Thomas Johnson. He was appointed in the 1700s, and he sat on the court for a year and a half, but it must have been a really unhappy experience because he was the grumpiest justice ever to sit on the court. Now, the reason I included Justice McReynolds at number 51 is that, by all accounts, Justice McReynolds is probably the worst person ever to sit on the Supreme Court. I didn't say the worst justice. I said the worst person ever to sit on the Supreme Court. He was awful to staff. He treated people very poorly. And most famously, or most infamously, he refused to shake Justice Brandeis's hand ever because he was Jewish. When Justice McReynolds died, no member of the court attended his funeral. It tells us something, that the worst person ever to sit on the Supreme Court only came in at number 51. It tells you how far the court has slid. Now, the court has these traditional signatures to opinions. Opinion of Justice Smith, Smith J concurring, Smith J concurring in the judgment, concurring in part, dissenting in part, Smith J dissenting. It seems to me that now that the court has been outed by this study, that it really ought to rethink this as a means of communicating not only with each other, but also with the public. So I want to offer some, in the spirit of helpfulness, I've crafted some new signatures for the court based on this study. So here we go, here's a suggestion. Alito J dissenting and feeling grumpy. Kennedy J splitting the difference since 1988. Scalia J really irked and looking for vindication at the next Federalist Society convention. Here's one for Justice Thomas. Thomas J just out there. I think the use of emoticons would help communicate with the modern generation as well, sort of a shorthand. Here's one for Justice Breyer. Breyer, musing and sometimes off topic. If the justices follow my suggestions, they may be able to communicate with each other well. So here's a matched set. Robert CJ concurring and talking trash. Sotomayor J dissenting right back at you. This also suggests the possibility of use of modern media. So here's one. So here's opinion per Kagan J at hashtag doing a whoop dance on your head. And finally, if we work with my suggestions, the court may be able to eliminate, for example, the public relations officer at the Supreme Court. And here's an example. Ginsburg dissenting and not even thinking of retiring as long as you guys keep writing stuff like this. So anyway, in a spirit of helpfulness, those are my suggestions for the court. And now here to tell us how grumpy the court was this term is my colleague, John Owens.
Well, we just got a tweet from Justice Kennedy. He will now not be showing up on Wednesday. So I think Judge Reinhold or maybe Judge Judy will be taking his place. All right, so I'm going to talk about some of the criminal cases this term. And there were some significant ones, some funny, some I think will have long impact on our courts. I'm going to start off with one of my favorite cases this term. It's called Yates versus United States. And if I can have that, great, thank you. So the question in Yates is whether what I call a fisherman's tale, taking actions to exaggerate the nature of one's fish catch, is a violation of the Enron obstruction statute, 18 U.S.C. 1519. In a 4-1-4 decision, so there's no controlling majority, the answer is no. So, let's set the scene. John Yates is a commercial fisherman in the Gulf of Mexico. He's catching red groupers. Unfortunately, the red groupers were shorter than the 20-inch limit. That limit now has been changed to 18 inches. So in terms of this being a significant, worthwhile prosecution, I'm not so sure. But anyway, at the time, there was a regulation that said if the fish were shorter than 20 inches, you couldn't catch them. So unfortunately for Mr. Yates, an inspector boarded the ship, measured the fish, and determined that 73 were undersized. So he issued a citation to Mr. Yates and ordered him to go to port and impound the fish for further inspection. Now, Captain Yates, unfortunately, instead of doing that, he instructed his crew to throw them overboard and replace them with bigger fish. And aside, the problem was this new batch of fish was also under 20 inches. So they get to port, they inspect the fish, they realize there's been a switcheroo, they start questioning the crew, a crew member cracks and confesses. So Yates is charged with two federal statutes, actually three. The first is 18 U.S.C. 2232, which is when you destroy evidence that's been impounded pursuant to a search warrant or something like that. The key statute here is 18 U.S.C. 1519, which is the destruction of a tangible object with the intent to instruct an investigation. This came after Enron. So both the district court and the Fifth Circuit said, yeah, tangible object. Fish is a tangible object. We're done. No. Because the Supreme Court disagreed. But how they disagreed is very interesting, and I think Judge Bybee's going to talk about it at the end. I think this decision is emblematic for future decisions of the court. So Justice Ginsburg went through all of the various canons and axioms of statutory interpretation to conclude that in this context, a fish is not a tangible object for 1519, and a lot of it talks about why when they pass 1519, they're talking about computer data being destroyed, papers, records, and so forth. No one would have thought about a fish. Now, Justice Kagan employed many of the canons and so forth to say a fish is a tangible object. I mean, a fish can fly out of the water and hit you in the head in the boat. I mean, it's a tangible object. And it's kind of the deciding vote here was Justice Alito, who kind of said, in effect, well, I don't really agree with either side, but the Justice Ginsburg opinion, I think, is closer. And so I'll go with that one. And that's really how the case was decided. So kind of what does this case teach us? Well, first it teaches you if you're going to switch out incriminating evidence, you know, if you're going to switch out, take away the bloody knife, don't put another bloody knife with your fingerprints on it. I mean, I'm just saying. I think the dissent is very interesting because it's the first time I believe that an opinion has cited Dr. Seuss. It's actually cited in there. And the other thing about the dissent, which I thought was more interesting to some of my colleagues on the court who would like to express opinions about things outside the court, is this language here, where she wrote, she says, look, judges have to follow the law. Okay. But if judges disagree with Congress's choice, we are perfectly entitled to say so in lectures and law review articles and even in dicta. So I know a lot of you worry. They say, am I ever going to be able to hear Judge Pragerson talk about the sentencing guidelines? I hope I do. Don't worry. He's got his cover now. He can continue to talk about the sentencing guidelines and how he feels about them. So that's the Yates case, and I think as Judge Bybee will indicate, there are some tensions here in how they dealt with this issue that has actually permeate maybe some of the bigger cases of this term. So the second case I'll talk about is a case called Rodriguez versus United States, and the question is this. During a traffic stop, and this case does not feature Dr. Seuss, by the way, I just don't have a slide for it. When you do a traffic stop, investigate it, and you're done with the traffic stop, and there's no reasonable suspicion to conduct anything further, may the police run a dog around the car anyway? Because the car's already stopped, it's not a big intrusion. And the Supreme Court once again said no. So in this case, and I think this would be for a lot of the border districts, where you're dealing with people driving down the 8 with cars loaded with drugs, for example, this could be an important case. So an officer observed a Mercury Mountaineer veer slowly onto the shoulder, which is a violation of the Nebraska traffic laws. Unfortunately for Mr. Rodriguez, that cop car happened to be a canine officer. A lot of these cases have very unfortunate defendants, and here's one of them. So the officer pulls over the car, speaks with Rodriguez, does a check, issues him a warning based on his driving record, and business is done. And the officer admitted at that point he had no reason to believe that there was any criminal activity afoot other than just some bad driving. He then asked Rodriguez permission to have the dog walk around the car, and Rodriguez said no. And 7 minutes passed, backup arrived, they had the dog then walk around the car without the consent of Mr. Rodriguez, and a dog alerted, and there was a bunch of methamphetamine in that car. So Rodriguez moved to suppress, but the Eighth Circuit said it was fine because there was a de minimis exception, in a sense, to the Fourth Amendment. Like, look, you were already stopped. That's already happened. To run the dog around a car is not a big deal. It's okay. The court reversed. It held that, which I frankly was surprised about. The court said that the length of any traffic stop must be limited by the stop's mission. So here, once the stop is done, it's done. You can't start tacking stuff on the end. Now, the dissent says, well, wait a second. You know, some cops are really efficient. Some aren't. So what, the really active super cop, you know, who's gonna check everything around, do it really quickly, he's done. He can't do further investigation. But if you get Columbo out there, you know, kind of doing his slow walk around the car, he can observe a lot more. But the majority said that's right, that once your business as a police officer is done, once the reason for the stop is done, you're done. You can't then start doing other stuff, even if it is a de minimis intrusion. The last case I'll talk about now, then I'll turn it over to Judge Watford next door, is actually one of Judge Watford's cases. All right, so the question in the case of City of Los Angeles versus Patel is, first, may a plaintiff bring a facial challenge to the Fourth Amendment, and specifically kind of to the merits of the case, and may the police inspect certain hotel records without any court order or exception to the warrant requirement? The answer to the first question is yes, plaintiffs can bring such a challenge, and no, the police may not inspect the records without some sort of court order or exception to the warrant requirement. So the Muni Code in Los Angeles has a provision that says hotels, you must record certain information about your guests. And they say the reason for it is because these hotels are used to traffic in narcotics, prostitution, child prostitution. So there are some very strong interests of the city to know what's going on. Not only does the hotel have to track this information, but if a police officer says, give it to me, the hotel must give it to them. There's no court order or subpoena or warrant required. So a group of motel operators challenged the law, and you know the issue is first, can they even do that? Can they bring that facial challenge? So the City of Los Angeles prevailed at trial, and our court and a 3-judge panel affirmed that result, but our court took it in bank, and in a 7-4 decision written by Judge Watford, joined by Judge Berzon, they said the provision violated the Fourth Amendment. And Judge Watford explained, applying the Supreme Court's administrative search cases, that this code provision did not provide the hotel operators with an opportunity for judicial review, or sometimes in the cases it's called pre-compliance review. And a search warrant, for example, has judicial review. A subpoena, you can move to quash it. But here, literally, you just had to hand it over with no one having a chance to say no or having a judge review it. Now, I will say, when cert was granted in this case, I was brand new to the court, and I said, oh, no. Ninth Circuit, we go in bank, saying something violates the Fourth Amendment, the court grants cert. Paul, I'm sorry, man, you know? I mean, this is not going to be good. But I was wrong, because the Supreme Court, in a 5-4 decision, agreed with Judge Watford and the majority, and largely followed his reasoning. And the court and Justice Sotomayor made clear that situations permitting unannounced inspections with no prejudicial review are very, very limited. In most situations, the subject of a search must be afforded an opportunity to obtain pre-compliance review before a neutral decision maker. Like I mentioned, chance to quash a subpoena, a judge has to review it, and so forth. Now, hotel owners can still consent to officers reviewing this information, and pre-compliance review is only when the hotel wants it. Now, Justice Scalia had a very passionate dissent about how this was a very bad result. Here in San Diego, for example, we actually had a prosecution of a travel lodge near Oceanside up near Camp Pendleton because they were running one of these prostitution rings in the hotel, and the hotel operators were actually charging higher prices to the gang members because they knew they were bringing in the young girls to work at these places. So it is a serious problem, but the majority said, look, we don't think this is a big deal. If there's really an extreme situation, the exigent circumstances doctrine still applies, so you can still get this information. So they did not view it the same way that Justice Scalia did. So, Paul, I'm going to be turning it over to you, but anything else you wanted to say about, was that your first case that went up?
Either that or Reed, yeah. Which I might talk about a little bit later. Those are the first two that
gotcha.
Went up.
Yeah. And it was a good feeling to be affirmed like that?
Better than getting reversed?
Yeah, sure. Well, I was going to say, we better get used to that on this circuit, but that was good.
I just wanted to make one comment about Rodriguez, which is that the opinion, really, to deal with this accusation that you could just have a slow officer, the response was, well, in fact, and I think that in some ways this is the more important part of the opinion, the Ginsburg opinion essentially says that even before the officer is finished and gives the citation, what they do has to be related to the traffic stop. So if, for example, before they gave the citation, they decided to run the dog, then if it ended up taking more time during that period, that could be a problem in itself. And in fact, we had an opinion in the Ninth Circuit that I wrote shortly afterwards in which the question was whether they could delay the traffic stop in order to do a search to find out whether, or a record search to find out whether the person had registered as a felon, and we said, no, that wasn't really connected to the traffic stop. They do warrant checks and so on, but this was an additional check, and we said that, so before they gave the citation, we said that's not relevant to the traffic stop, and there's a lot of language in the opinion that says that, and I think in some ways that's going to be the more important part of the opinion.
Okay, well, I'm going to speak relatively briefly about two of the Supreme Court's civil rights cases. There are many more that I wish I could cover, but I only have time to cover two. The first will be Obergefell, the same-sex marriage case, and the second will be the Fair Housing Act case, which is Texas Department of Housing and Community Affairs versus the Inclusive Communities Project, Inc. Let me start with Obergefell. I'll back this up a little bit. No introduction needed for that case, obviously, and I won't dwell on the background or the lineup, but I thought I'd make just a few observations about the rationale that the court majority adopted to reach the result that it did. The first interesting thing was obviously that the court relied much more heavily on the Due Process Clause of the 14th Amendment rather than the Equal Protection Clause. I think that was surprising to a lot of people. You might recall from the briefing and oral argument in the case that the United States participated in the case and submitted both a brief, and the Solicitor General participated in the oral argument, and they argued exclusively that the law should be invalidated on the basis of the Equal Protection Clause. That's not really the route the court took. The first point that's garnered a lot of commentary is just what exactly is the status of the court's rule from Glucksberg. Glucksberg, you'll remember, was one of the more recent cases in which the Supreme Court tried to cabin the reach of substantive due process. And it did so by saying that whenever you're going to try to determine whether a particular right is recognized as fundamental, you've got to define it in the narrowest way possible. And the court quite explicitly in Obergefell said, certainly the court has to be guided by history and tradition, but it's not bound by it. And you can imagine that in this case, if the court had defined the claimed right in the narrowest possible form, it would have been something like, you know, has there been a history and tradition of recognizing same-sex marriage in the country? And the answer obviously would have been no. So the court started with the proposition that everyone could agree with and said, obviously the right to marry has been recognized as fundamental. That's defined at a fairly broad level of generality. And then it explored each of the four principles or each of the four traditions, kind of underlying reasons why that right has been recognized as fundamental. And basically it went through each of those and said, we don't see any basis for distinguishing between opposite sex couples and same-sex couples. And so I'll run through those real quickly. The first was the right to marry is fundamental because it implicates individual autonomy, right? I mean, there are few decisions any of us make in our life that will have a greater impact on the future course of our lives. And that's one of the reasons why the court has traditionally given such strong protection to the right to marry. And again, the court looked at that interest and said, we don't see why folks who are in same-sex relationships, why that interest in autonomy is any less for them. It mentioned that one interesting thing is that the court repeatedly stressed the unique nature of the two-person relationship that marriage entails. I suppose to try to cut off perhaps future arguments that might be made about folks who want to be involved in plural marriages. But the court stressed that marriage forms a two-person union unlike any other relationship that two human beings can form. Again, look to same-sex couples, no reason why that's not equally true for them. The third interest was in terms of why the right to marriage has been recognized as fundamental, is that it safeguards children and families. And the court, as it did in Windsor, placed quite a bit of stress on the harm to children that results from same-sex couples being denied the right to marry. And in fact, at one point, the court stressed that the effect of the laws being challenged in Obergefell was to harm and humiliate children of same-sex couples. So again, the court looked at the interest as to why marriage has been traditionally extended to opposite-sex couples, interest in protecting children, looked to same-sex couples who also were raising children, and said, again, we see no reason why that interest shouldn't extend equally to them. And then finally, the court stressed that marriage has always been viewed as the keystone of our social order. And you know, obviously it's the building block for much of society and grants, gives a measure of stability to relationships. But again, looked to same-sex couples and said there's no reason why that interest doesn't extend equally to them. What's interesting about the court's analysis on that front is that it never explicitly stated what standard of review it was applying. We might have assumed, given that the right being discussed, the right to marry has been deemed fundamental, that strict scrutiny would apply. But the court never said that. It never identified explicitly what standard of review it was applying. Now, I guess I find one of the more surprising aspects of the decision the fact that the court didn't place more weight on the Equal Protection Clause. The court certainly mentioned the clause and stressed that there's synergy between the Due Process and Equal Protection Clauses, and in some ways there, I think the way the court put it is there's a profound connection between the interests protected by both. But the court really didn't give any freestanding weight to the Equal Protection Clause as part of its analysis. And one of the interesting questions, or perhaps criticisms that people have raised, is whether the court should have placed more weight on the equal protection analysis. And perhaps had it done so, it would have felt compelled to identify more explicitly. I apologize for my voice. It's a little early for me. I'm not the morning person. It might have required the court to more explicitly identify the level of scrutiny that should be applied. I think there are two reasons, in my view, why it is surprising that the court didn't stress more the equal protection component of the analysis. The first is that the court said quite explicitly at the beginning of the opinion that the basis for the classifications at issue here, sexual orientation, is actually an immutable characteristic of human nature. And in fact, the court cited with approval one of the amicus briefs submitted by, I think it was the American Psychological Association, in which this is the view that the court seemed to endorse. It said, sexual orientation is both a normal expression of human sexuality and immutable. Normally, we think of immutable characteristics as leading to designating a class as a suspect class who would be entitled to heightened protection. So the court sort of suggested that sexual orientation is, in fact, an immutable characteristic, but didn't go further than that. And the second is that the second reason I think it's a little surprising the court didn't put more weight on the Equal Protection Clause is that it did stress, and in fact expressed its holding in terms of same-sex couples being excluded from an institution that is otherwise made available to opposite-sex couples. And actually, when the court expressed its sort of bottom-line judgment, it said that the challenge laws are invalid to the extent they exclude same-sex couples from civil marriage on the same terms and conditions as opposite-sex couples. So obviously, the court seemed to be suggesting very much an equal protection rationale for its decision, but again, it didn't give any freestanding weight to the Equal Protection Clause at all. One of the questions I think that's raised by the fact that the court stressed more the fundamental rights aspect of the analysis, more of the substantive due process rationale, is that it leads to the question whether, you know, was it trying to suggest, perhaps because of the equality component of the rationale I mentioned, was it trying to suggest that sexual orientation, like race and gender, is, you know, an aspect of one's identity that should be basically be irrelevant when the government decides what benefits to confer or what benefits or what burdens to impose? One might read Obergefell in that way. That would obviously be the broader reading. But alternatively, because the court stressed so much the fact that what was at issue was a fundamental right, I guess the narrower reading would be that it is fine for the government to distinguish between people on the basis of sexual orientation, just so long as the law doesn't implicate a fundamental right. Which of those two readings the lower courts and ultimately perhaps the Supreme Court, if it revisits the issue, which of those two readings the court adopts is obviously going to have a very big impact on how broad the reach of Obergefell ends up being. I think one of the I've heard now a number of comparisons being made. Obergefell being made to Brown versus Board of Education. And I think there's no question that already Obergefell is going to be one of the landmark decisions of our time. But the interesting thing, I suppose, is whether, like Brown, Obergefell will be a kind of a catalyst for the type of legislative change that we saw in the wake of Brown. Obviously, that the legislature can extend protection against discrimination to a much broader category of activities of daily life than the Supreme Court can by interpreting the Constitution, which of course only applies to the government. So it may be that in the decades ahead, we will look back and perhaps Obergefell will be a catalyst again for the kind of legislative change that a lot of people are already talking about. Let me turn briefly to the Fair Housing Act case. Which is the Texas Department of Housing and Community Affairs versus the Inclusive Communities Project, Inc. That case involved a very narrow issue, and it was whether the Fair Housing Act allows disparate impact claims. It ended up being really a question of straight statutory interpretation, and in some ways, it's of a piece with some of the other cases, perhaps the Yates case that Judge Owens mentioned, perhaps King versus Burwell, which I think Judge Bybee is going to touch on. The law at issue there in the Fair Housing Act stated that it is unlawful to either decline to rent or sell a dwelling or otherwise make unavailable a dwelling to anyone because of that person's race, religion, et cetera. There are a number of protected grounds that are listed. The court had long interpreted the phrase because of to require proof of discriminatory intent, discriminatory animus, something like that. And so the dissenters, this was another 5-4 decision with the same lineup as Obergefell, the dissenters said, well, what part of that statute can't you understand? It says clearly that the action taken, even if it means making unavailable a dwelling, has to be because of a protected ground, and that means that there's got to be some kind of an intent involved. The court rejected that plain language reading of the statute and was quite willing, actually, to look to broader purposes. The broader purpose of the Fair Housing Act obviously was to eliminate barriers in the housing realm that minorities have faced historically. And the court was instead willing to look to how the court had interpreted similar language in Title VII. The court in Title VII had construed a similar passage to mean that disparate impact claims could be brought. And the court basically transported that reasoning into the Fair Housing Act and said the otherwise make unavailable phrase should be given the same meaning. The court also was willing to be influenced by the fact that the Fair Housing Act was passed in 1968. And basically in the 20 years after that point, I think it was 9 circuit courts of appeals had construed the act to allow disparate impact claims. And Congress had amended the statute, had never decided to explicitly say that that lower courts had gotten that wrong. So in 1988, Congress amended the statute again, and this time added several exemptions from liability, which the court placed a lot of weight on because it said those exemptions from liability sort of assumed that disparate impact liability was available, and in fact, those exemptions would have been meaningless had disparate impact liability not been available under the statute. So the court kind of pieced together Congress's inaction on the one hand in failing to overrule the unanimous line of circuit court precedent that had developed over the years, and Congress's affirmative decision to insert these exemptions that seemed to presuppose the existence of disparate impact liability, put that together with the broad purposes of the act and concluded that that disparate impact claims should be recognized under the act. And again, as I said, there were 4 dissenters who dissented quite vigorously on the ground that the court had basically just ignored the plain language of the statute. One of the things that Justice Kennedy's majority opinion did in the Fair Housing Act case is that it was quite willing to recognize the existence of disparate impact liability, but at the same time, he stressed that such liability had to be very narrowly construed in the housing context, perhaps even more narrowly construed than it has been in the employment context. And the reason for that, at least some of the concern expressed, was that if the cause of action weren't narrowly construed, states and municipalities might feel compelled to adopt race-conscious measures to avoid disparate impact liability that would themselves raise constitutional questions. And so, for example, the court held that states and municipalities have to be given considerable leeway when offering non-discriminatory justifications for adopting the policies that are being challenged. And in addition, there is what the court described, there needs to be a fairly robust causality requirement that ties the policy that's being challenged to the disparate impact on minorities. The court sent the case that came to it from the Fifth Circuit back down, but it seemed to strongly suggest that the particular claim at issue in that case should not be likely to succeed on remand because the policy being challenged there was the allocation of tax credits to developers for the construction of low-income housing. The tax credits were being allocated more heavily to developments in inner-city, predominantly African-American neighborhoods, and the challenge was that, hey, the state or municipality there should have allocated more credits to developments in suburban, predominantly white areas. And the court seemed to suggest that it would be hard to challenge that on that policy on a disparate impact theory because there could be two different ways of looking at that as legitimate, either that you wanted to make sure that housing in inner city areas was improved, and that would be a perfectly legitimate interest of the government, or that obviously more housing developments for low-income residents should be built in suburban areas and allow folks the opportunity to move out of the inner city. So we will have to see we'll have to see what lower courts do with this new, not new, but newly sanctioned disparate impact claim that the Supreme Court has approved. And I will leave it there so that we don't run out of time.
thank you. I'm going to cover religious liberty. The principal case here is Holt versus Hobbs. It's a case under RLUIPA, the Religious Land Use and Institutionalized Persons Act of 2000. Holt was an Arkansas inmate and a devout Muslim who wanted to grow his beard 1/2 inch in accordance with his religion. His religion actually required him to grow a beard of much longer length, but he was willing to compromise and only grow a 1/2 inch beard. Under the rules of the Arkansas Department of Corrections, its prisoners were prohibited from growing beards, but they were willing to make an exception for those inmates with diagnosed skin conditions, and they were allowed to grow a beard of 1/4 inch. So he wanted 1/2 inch, they wanted 1/4 inch, and he sought an exemption on religious grounds, which the Department of Corrections denied. So he brings a suit under RLUIPA. The court, in a 9-0 opinion written by Justice Alito, held for the prisoner. Okay, this is a remarkable result. Let me try and put it in context. So the outlines of the decision are the department's grooming policy violated RLUIPA insofar as it prevents Holt from growing a 1/2 inch beard and according with his religious beliefs. There is a two-step process. I'm going to come back to this in just a minute, so let me just cover this quickly. The court found that Holt easily satisfied the first step, which was his burden of proving that there was a substantial burden on the exercise of his sincerely held religious beliefs. Court says that's easily satisfied here. He can do that. At that point, the burden then shifts to the Department of Corrections to show that it has a compelling interest in its rules and that this is the least restrictive means. And here the court says the Department of Corrections rules fail. The court said that the department has a compelling interest in preventing contraband from being introduced into American prisons, but the department didn't require inmates to shave their head. And it hadn't explained why it couldn't search a beard just like it searched inmates' clothing. So it didn't satisfy that least restrictive alternative. So although the department had compelling interests, it couldn't satisfy the least restrictive alternatives component of that test. All right, a couple of points worth noting. First, this is one of two wins during the term for Muslims. The second one was not brought under RLUIPA or RFRA, but it was brought under Title VII. That was EEOC versus Abercrombie and Fitch, where a young Muslim woman named Samantha Eloff had interviewed with Abercrombie and Fitch, and she was wearing a headscarf when she interviewed. And that did not satisfy Abercrombie and Fitch's look policy. Their look policy deems caps too informal for their employees. In an 8-1 decision written by Justice Scalia said Abercrombie and Fitch had violated Title VII. The religious practice had to be accommodated, and it was no defense to say that Abercrombie and Fitch had a neutral policy because Title VII is not neutral with respect to religion. So that's sort of my first point about Holt versus Hobbs, the Arkansas case. This is one of two big wins on religious grounds for Muslims during the term. Now, the court has been fairly religion-friendly over the last couple of years. We've had two big decisions in the last 3 years. The first one in 2012 was Hosanna Tabor, Evangelical Lutheran Church, which dealt with the ministerial exception to Title VII. Then there's last year's decision in Hobby Lobby, which was the RFRA challenge to the Affordable Care Act. In my view, I think Holt versus Hobbs may be even more important than either of those decisions, and here's why. For decades, we have assumed that the Free Exercise Clause required that an adherent prove, first, substantial burden on the exercise of religion, and second, then that the burden shifts to the government to show that its policy is compelling, and that the policy is in furtherance of the least restrictive alternative. That's a classic statement of strict scrutiny. That standard as a constitutional standard, that is, as a free exercise standard, is the result of two important cases, which I know you will recognize. The first is the 1963 case in the South Carolina unemployment insurance context called Sherbert versus Verner. The second one is the 1972 case involving compulsory education in Wisconsin and the Amish. That's Yoder versus Wisconsin. That test as a free exercise test is derived from those two cases. Those two cases never lived up to their billing. In the end, Yoder really only benefited the Amish, and Sherbert versus Verner, turns out, never really had any truck except in the context of unemployment insurance. In case after case after case in the 70s and in the 80s, the government won every time. We had challenges under Social Security laws and prison contexts and driver's licenses and so on. The government wins almost all of those cases. This charade ends in 1990 with Justice Scalia's very controversial decision in Employment Division versus Smith. That's the, that is the Oregon case involving the use of peyote. And although Smith didn't overrule Sherbert and Yoder, there are a lot of people who thought that effectively it had. And Congress reacts very quickly. It first adopts RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, part of which is struck down, that portion as it applied to the states, was struck down in Bernie versus Flores, and Congress returns with a statute that does apply to the states, and that is RLUIPA. So between RFRA, which applies only to the federal government, RLUIPA, which applies to the states, we now have statutory protection that promised to restore the standard of Sherbert versus Verner and Yoder versus Wisconsin. The question is, well, those cases never had any power of their own. If they get codified, does that make a difference? I think that Holt answers yes, that all of a sudden there is a payoff here that we never had under the Constitution itself. This is a huge win for religious liberty, and not the least because it occurs in the prison context. The government has always won in the prison context. The classic case, 1987, is Olon versus the state of Shabazz. All of a sudden, RFRA and RLUIPA look like they have teeth that the Free Exercise Clause never had. So the case was unanimous. It's an opinion by Justice Alito, who as a circuit justice had taken a very pro-religion stance. So we will have to see, but right now this looks like this is a really important decision. Now, it also looks like it may be an important decision for another reason, and that's because of Obergefell. So it may be an indirect consequence of Obergefell. Holt was issued 4 days after the court granted certiorari in that case. And the court could not have been ignorant of the various controversies surrounding whether bakeries must supply cakes for gay weddings or ministers must perform such marriages. At oral argument in Obergefell, Solicitor General Don Verrilli suggested that the government might use tax-exempt status rules to enforce the right to same-sex marriage against charitable institutions that oppose it. This is the so-called Bob Jones power. So Justice Kennedy, in the opinion that, my colleague Judge Watford just covered, was sufficiently concerned with these issues that he addressed it in dicta. Now, here's what he said, and the Chief Justice did in his dissent as well. So Justice Kennedy wrote that religions and those who adhere to religious doctrines may continue to advocate that same-sex marriage should not be condoned. Now, we ought to note right up front that advocate and teach would seem to fall within the free speech clause and not within the free exercise clause or within some kind of statutory protection such as RFRA or RLUIPA. So the dicta might not mean very much, but it was really interesting that Justice Kennedy went out of his way to offer some reassurance that its new rules might not affect certain kinds of religious practices or teachings. Now, the Chief Justice, in his dissent in Obergefell, went even farther and warned that federal courts are blunt instruments and that Obergefell creates serious questions about religious liberty. So it will be an interesting question as to how much power Holt has. There may be some clash of titans here between the rights that have been conferred in Obergefell and probably await us through the Equal Protection Clause and certain kinds of religious practices. These are going to be hard questions. I don't know what the answers are, but it looks to me as though Holt has bred new life into the statutory protection for religion. With that, I'm going to turn it back to my colleague, Judge Owens.
Sure, a few more criminal cases to discuss. The first is Ohio versus Clark. For those of you in districts that have a lot of trials involving child witnesses, for example, some of the, we'll leave it on that one for right now. For those of you in districts that have child testimony, I think of, for example, Montana, I think of in the Southern District of California because of Camp Pendleton, this is an important case. The Supreme Court held that child testimony or child statements given, for example, to a daycare worker, where a child says, my dad hit me or my mom hit me. And if you call the daycare worker and you do not call the child to testify, that does not raise Confrontation Clause concerns. There is a lot of dicta in the majority opinion written by Justice Alito suggesting all kinds of other statements do not implicate the Confrontation Clause. For example, there's strong language in the opinion, which I think can be viewed as dicta, saying that statements made to non-governmental actors are rarely going to implicate the Confrontation Clause. I think for AUSAs, they're always trying to figure out, for example, how do we introduce statements given during an internal investigation where a law firm comes in and interviews a bunch of people at a business? There is an argument to be made that this case, Ohio versus Clark, suggests that those statements could come in, as long as there's a hearsay exception, could come in because they are not made to governmental actors. This case also shows a real battle between Justice Scalia and Justice Alito over the Confrontation Clause. Justice Scalia concurred in the result. He said, look, in this context, I agree that these statements did not implicate the Confrontation Clause. But Justice Alito, you keep shoveling dirt on the Confrontation Clause. Literally, that's what he said. He called this as an attempt to return to the old days of the Ohio versus Roberts standard, which is Justice Scalia called a flabby test that prosecutors love. If you had asked me in 2004, would I think that these statements would come in, I would have said no. Reading Crawford, I don't think so. I'm not sure where we are in this area, so I'm looking at my district court colleagues, good luck with this one. So the next case I'll talk about is Alonis, which deals with online threats. So now if we can go ahead and have the PowerPoint back up. Okay. So in Alonis posted all kinds of terrible Facebook postings about killing his wife, shooting up a school, really bad stuff. And so he was charged under 18 U.S.C. 1875, which is about making threats in certain communications. The Third Circuit gave the instruction, which was the instruction in the majority of circuits, that said if a reasonable person would foresee, kind of a negligence standard. And the Supreme Court said, in the context of this statute, no. You have to either intend or know that the threat will be viewed as a threat by the recipient, not that you should have known. Now, frankly, I think I was an AUSA for many years, and the Ninth Circuit actually got this right, according to the court. In fact, Justice Thomas, in dissent, called the Ninth Circuit one of those outlier circuits, which the majority happened to agree with, which was good to see. But I think in terms of proving the case, if I were arguing the case, I would say, well, of course he knew by telling someone that he's going to shoot up a kindergarten, they would view this as a threat. I don't think that the read here, I don't think, is as big, frankly, as the majority in the dissent thought it was in this case. I would argue the case the same way as a prosecutor. But keep giving the model instructions the Ninth Circuit has given, and you should be fine, according to the Supreme Court. The last case, which I'll spend a little bit more time on, is Johnson versus United States. Oh, by the way, the next slide's a little odd. I wasn't sure people knew what emojis or emoticons were. So to use an example, Judge Reinhart has expressed certain views about habeas corpus and qualified immunity. Now, you can read his article, or you can look at what his emoticon would be, which would be something like this. So I wasn't sure people knew. Okay, so the last case I'm going to talk about is Johnson versus the United States. This, I think, from those of us who follow the criminal law very closely, this is potentially a very big case for the circuit, and especially for our district court judges who are going to be facing this issue constantly. So the question presented appeared very simple. Should mere possession of a short-barreled shotgun be treated as a violent felony under the Armed Career Criminal Act? Now, seems like a fairly straightforward question, but for those of us who have dealt with this statute over the years, this is a very difficult question. So the court many times has analyzed whether other statutes qualify as a so-called violent felony. And the reason why this is significant, well, first, for those of you who don't know what a short-barreled shotgun is, this is an example. You remember Arnold Schwarzenegger in Terminator 2. You'd be amazed what you find on the internet these days. You know, you have this one here. Anyway, so why is it important? Why is it significant? Well, under the so-called residual clause of the Armed Career Criminal Act, any felony that, quote, involves conduct that presents a serious potential risk of physical injury to another is a violent felony. And if you qualify for this, it's a 15-year mandatory minimum. It is a brutal statute. Now, there are some defendants who earn it, but I say this as a former AUSA, there are a lot of cases where, frankly, I didn't think they did. But the statute says what it says, it's what Congress said. So this is a big issue. And so courts over the years have dealt with, is reckless driving qualify it? And it can be very, very troubling and very difficult to figure this all out. But anyway, this was the question of the case. You saw the question presented. Some people speculated maybe this is the case that the court is going to really take a hard look at. Is this just vague? Can we just not apply this law? But the case was argued. It didn't come up. Wasn't really briefed. We figure, okay, we're going to get another one of these cases that we're all going to have to go back and figure out, okay, now is the next possession of nunchucks, is that a violent felony? I don't have a picture of nunchucks, but, those things you swing around. But are we going to have to, every time the statute comes up, are we going to have to keep doing this analysis? But then something very interesting happened. So the case was argued on November 5th of 2014. More than 2 months later, the court issues an order. We're going to re-argue this case. Now the question presented is whether the residual clause in the Armed Career Criminal Act is unconstitutionally vague. This is the big ticket question. And the court held overwhelmingly that it was. So the so-called residual clause, which required all you judges to try to figure out is some Texas driving statute, that's gone. I think the bigger question is, what about other parts of the criminal law? So Justice Scalia said, in analyzing this question, it's been said that the life of the law is experience. 9 years experience trying to derive meaning from the residual clause convinces us that we have embarked upon a failed enterprise. We have already seen in the Ninth Circuit in the past week, I believe, a career offender provision being held to be vague. And we already seen in the 28J context in the Ninth Circuit many, many people arguing that many statutes are vague. I fully anticipate that district court judges, if you haven't already, will be receiving all kinds of 2255s arguing this in a variety of contexts. It's not just federal laws. It could be a state second-degree murder in California. It's hard to predict how these cases will roll out, but remember, the whole Booker started as a dissent in Almendarez-Torres. I don't know if this is going to be that big of a case, but if I were a district court judge and I had to read one criminal case this term, this would be it. I think this is the big case to pay attention to.
Okay, I'm going to talk just a little bit about constitutional interpretation. I'm sorry, did I just step on Judge Watford's toes?
No,
I did.
Yeah, it's your turn.
Walker.
Sorry. Yeah, all right, well,
my fault. I'm not going to talk about constitutional interpretation right now.
Yeah.
Well, I will be very quick because we are running quite low on time. I was tasked with talking about some of the Supreme Court's First Amendment cases this term, and I'll just mention two very briefly. The first is Walker. That's the Confederate flag case out of Texas. You'll recall that they're a private group, the what is the name of it? The Sons of Confederate Veterans proposed a license plate that had featured quite prominently an image of the Confederate battle flag on it. The Texas DMV rejected that, saying that it would be likely to be viewed as too offensive to many people in the community. And the Sons of Confederate Veterans sued to seeking an injunction to be permitted to use that display on the license plates. The court ended up being confronted really with one basic question, which is, was the license plate display there private speech or government speech? If it was deemed private speech, clearly the Texas DMV would have engaged in viewpoint discrimination and its action would have been invalid. But the court held that, in fact, it was government speech. And again, it was 5-4, but with a slight twist in the lineup. Justice Thomas provided the fifth vote to the four more liberal justices. Justice Breyer, am I remembering that? Justice Breyer wrote the opinion? Yes, Justice Breyer wrote the opinion. What the court held is basically that the outcome there was dictated by the decision in Summum, if I'm saying that right, the decision from, I think, 2009 involving the placement of monuments in city parks. And you'll recall that there the court held that even though it was similar, where private groups were sponsoring the messages on the monuments, once the government accepted it and place it in the park, it was deemed to be government speech. The court basically followed that exact same rationale with respect to the license plates. It said that the state of Texas owned the license plates. It had to approve the messages that it put on there. And even though a lot of these messages were pretty far afield from any interest that that the state might have, for example, some of the messages were like, "I'd rather be golfing," which kind of a message that Justice Alito mocked in his dissent. Because surely, he said, it can't be the case that if you saw someone driving by at 8:30 on a Monday morning with a license plate that said that, that you'd assume that the official policy of the state of Texas was that it was better to be golfing than to go to work. But nonetheless, the court was persuaded that that everything on the license plates constituted government speech, and therefore it was completely exempt, really, from any First Amendment analysis, and that's the way that case got resolved. Very briefly on Reed. Reed was the sign ordinance case out of Arizona. The municipality there had a fairly broad sign ordinance that said basically no signs permitted anywhere without a permit, except it carved out all of these exemptions. And the exemptions were gave different treatment to different types of signs based on the subject matter that the sign conveyed. And the court there held unanimously that that distinction between different types of signs was invalid. But the somewhat surprising aspect of the decision was that the court split 6-3 on the rationale. Six of the justices held that because the sign ordinance on its face drew content-based distinctions, it was automatically subject to strict scrutiny. Three justices thought that it was unnecessary to go quite that far and instead would have struck down the sign ordinance under intermediate scrutiny. Some people have already started to suggest that the courts, that the majority's holding here will call into question all sorts of government regulations that deal probably not just with signs, but anything, any other regulations dealing with speech, because the courts drew a fairly rigid categorical line saying that as soon as an ordinance on its face starts to draw distinctions based on the content of the speech, it will automatically be subject to strict scrutiny and, as we all know, most likely be struck down. So that decision will likely have quite a broad impact unless it's cut back further by the Supreme Court in subsequent cases. So I'll turn it back to Jay.
Thank you. As we tried to make decisions about what cases to cover, we had to make some really hard decisions. And I'm going to make a hard decision right now. We are trying to leave a few minutes for question and answer, so I'm going to cover some things very quickly, just in some general impressions about constitutional and statutory interpretation. The court had some huge battles over both constitutional interpretation and statutory interpretation. And in a couple of cases, the battle really is whether you take the microscopic view, that is, how strict a textualist are we going to be, or whether you're going to take the macroscopic view, sort of the 10,000-foot view of the statute. And there were a couple of as I said, titanic struggles over this one. I'm going to mention two cases, but it's applicable in a number of other cases that my colleagues have referred to. The Fish case, that was Yates. The Judge Owens referred to the Texas housing case that my colleague Judge Watford referred to. I have to begin, though, before I start talking about King versus Burwell, which was the ACA case, about an important distinction between the court's approach to interpreting statutes and interpreting the Constitution. It may sound counterintuitive to us, but the court is far more final with respect to statutes than it is with respect to the Constitution. That is, the court is far more willing to re-examine its interpretation of the Constitution and to overrule itself than it is to re-examine its statutory rulings. Now, there's a reason for that, and the reason is grounded in the separation of powers. The court is deferring to Congress here. So once the court has interpreted a statute, it's not going to back down, because its philosophy is that if Congress disagrees with us, and sometimes the court is very open about this, and sometimes the dissenters will invite Congress to change things. The thought is, if we've made a mistake here, Congress has the power to change that. So, for example, we had an interpretation of the Pregnancy Discrimination Act in the 80s and a very controversial decision called General Electric versus Gilbert. Congress reacted almost immediately to that with a statutory fix called the Pregnancy Discrimination Act. So in King versus Burwell, this is the ACA case turned on four words. The four words were established by the state. And the question was whether exchanges established by the state, that phrase established by the state, which were eligible for certain favorable tax status, whether exchanges established by the state also included exchanges established by HHS. The court answered yes. And it's a titanic battle between the Chief Justice, who writes for the majority, and Justice Scalia, writing for the dissent. Now, recall what I said about the court interpreting statutes as opposed to the Constitution. The court will not revisit its statutory interpretation because it believes that if Congress disagrees with it, it will amend the statute. Thus, if the court has made a mistake, Congress can correct it. And sometimes courts will adhere to literal language as a disciplining function for congressional sloppiness. If this is not what Congress meant, then fix it and say what you mean. The problem was, everybody knew that wasn't going to happen in this case. This was the president's signature act, and everybody knew that there would be no congressional response to fix this if the court took the literal interpretation of exchanges established by the state. And the consequences were enormous. If the court had sided with the Virginia taxpayers, then the ACA was likely doomed. And the majority ends up saving the act and taking the macro view. The court, in the process, the Chief Justice acknowledges that the ACA has more than a few examples of what he called inartful drafting, and that the act did not reflect the type of care and deliberation that one might expect of such significant legislation. In the end, he found that an exchange established by the state was ambiguous, and that the phrase might refer to state exchanges, or it might refer to state and federal exchanges. And because it was ambiguous, the court would look to the broader structure of the act. Now, at this point, the court becomes more consequentialist than it does interpretivist. The court concludes the statutory scheme compels us to reject the taxpayer's interpretation because it would destabilize the individual insurance markets in any state with a federal exchange, and thus likely create the death spirals that Congress designed the act to avoid. Thus, the chief said, the court must be careful not to undo what Congress has done. And Congress passed the Affordable Care Act to improve health insurance markets, not to destroy them. Okay, it's a very, very broad principle of interpretation. It really is a 10,000-foot view of the act. Congress didn't intend to destroy the insurance markets. This is going to destroy the insurance markets if we doom this act, and therefore that can't be what Congress meant. The second case I want to talk about just briefly was a constitutional case, and that was the Arizona State Legislature versus Arizona Independent Redistricting Commission. This had to do with an initiative adopted by the people of Arizona. So this is an end run around their legislature. It's direct democracy. And which they adopted a commission that was designed to redistrict the legislature in order to avoid political gerrymanders. And the question is whether under Article 1, Section 4 of the Constitution, whether the people of Arizona could do this. Because the because Article 1, Section 4 says that the state legislatures control the time, place, and manner of the elections in the state. So the question was whether legislature, as used in the Constitution, also includes the people of the state voting in initiatives. And in a 5-4 decision by Justice Ginsburg, the court said yes. Once again, this is a 10,000-foot view because there isn't really much of a, I have to be honest, there isn't much of a good argument that legislature is used in the Constitution means the people of the state. There is some effort at intertextualism, but most of the hard work is done in the dissent by Chief Justice Roberts, who includes an appendix of all the instances in the Constitution where the word legislature is used, and he says not only are there places where it doesn't mean, it does, it most likely doesn't mean the legislature or the people constituted as a whole, he said, but the Constitution is very careful, it cannot mean anything else. It's a little, again, a little bit of a consequentialist approach because Justice Ginsburg begins her opinion with the declaration that gerrymanders are bad for the democratic process. And if we start from that presumption, then that may influence the way that we see the Constitution. As I look at most of the statutory cases or the constitutional cases that involve sort of hard interpretation, the Yates case was the one example where I could find that there really were dueling aphorisms, there were dueling rules that were at stake in both sides, and I think that both sides had a very legitimate argument about constitutional interpretation. In the other cases, it looks like strict interpretation lost in each of the cases. So, and a very interesting term. I don't know if there's any enduring principles that come out of those cases, but certainly when you look at the broad term, the court was going to be very loose in the way it was interpreting statutes. And with that, I'll turn it back to Justice Berzon.
Two quick comments on the Arizona case, and then we have about 10 minutes for questions. One about the Arizona case is that the majority opinion, Justice Ginsburg's opinion, suggests that legislature quite specifically that the legislature in the Constitution means different things in different clauses, and she reads this clause as referring to the legislature as a lawmaking body, but that in other instances where the legislature has different roles, such as calling for the ratification of a new constitutional amendment or in the prior version before the amendment to the Constitution electing senators, that's a different role for the legislature. So she's very conscientious about that. But secondly, and I thought this was really interesting, the argument in the case, because I read the briefs beforehand and read the argument. The original argument was sort of on 2 feet. One was that the this couldn't be done by initiative, but also there was seemed to be an argument that it couldn't be done at all. That is, that the a commission could not be the redistricting body, whether chosen by initiative or chosen by or set up through the ordinary legislative process, because the commission watches in the legislature. That argument is not mentioned, it's not discussed. Nobody responds to it at all. I don't know whether it's still hanging out there or exactly what its status is. All right, we have a few minutes for questions. Okay, this is very peculiar. Oh, yes. Claudia.
Sounds like a question for Judge Watford.
Well, I don't think it's surprising that we didn't have a lot of separate opinions. You're saying from, say, Justices Ginsburg, Breyer, Sotomayor, or Kagan. No, I think there was, Justice Ginsburg has said, even as recently, I think, as the other day, that there's been a conscious decision to try to limit the number of separate opinions, especially in a case of that magnitude. I think it would have detracted probably from the force of Justice Kennedy's opinion had there been, you know, two or three separate opinions. You know, it is interesting, though, I think, in terms of the fact that the equal protection issue really wasn't engaged. I don't think the dissenters felt any need to, because obviously the majority hadn't relied on it heavily. I recall, I think there was just one sentence in Chief Justice Roberts' dissent in which he said, well, he assumed that rational basis review would apply, and he said, obviously it has to be rational for a state to want to uphold the traditional definition of marriage. That was literally the entirety of the kind of you know, level of scrutiny-based analysis that that was contained. The rest was just off in a totally different direction.
My view on that is, well, first of all, just two observations. One is that Obergefell, even though it doesn't comment on the Equal Protection Clause, has to have implications for going forward. And we'll have to struggle with those first, and maybe the court will get around to it at some point. But it just has to have some kind of implications for the Equal Protection Clause going forward. And the second my second observation is, this was so high profile and was such a battle between the conservatives that there was no reason for the liberals to get in on this one. They were happy to stand on the sidelines. They had Justice Kennedy. They couldn't say anything that was going to help Justice Kennedy feel better about this by offering opinions on something else. And so they were happy to let Justice Kennedy battle, fend off the conservatives on the court, and were happy to win and just stay out of it. It's a really interesting question. It's quite possible. I think there's no question that over the last 30 years that Justice Scalia and others have changed the conversation. So they've changed the nature of the vocabulary as we talk about the Constitution. So even people who might have been inclined to talk about the living Constitution are willing to use textual terms in talking about that. We have a number of academics who have written about this and are writing about textualism, but writing about it from a perspective that is really quite more accommodating to a living Constitution. Whether this is the beginning of a new era in Supreme Court interpretation or a return to a prior era, I don't know. We'll have to wait a couple more terms. See me in 2020.
I should say that Obergefell is sort of its own thing. So it is what it is, and my answer to Claudia's question would be that nobody was going to quarrel with whatever Justice Kennedy wanted to say in this opinion, and this is what he wanted to say. But I do somewhat disagree with Judge Bybee on the Arizona case as being an example of a non-literalist or living, necessarily living Constitution view, because I think that both historically, as I understand it, it seemed to me that the historical data kind of washed in terms of whether the intent was to be talking about a particular body or whatever the legislative system is in the state. And that seemed to me to be a fair debate, and I don't know that case can be seen as buying into a particular ideological view of the Constitution. Obergefell, yes. We would have if there. It was next on the list.
It was actually on my list of cases to talk about. This is one where again there's a little bit of a consequentialist approach, because if wellness had come out differently, not only would we have had the court actually says right up front, we are well aware that if we decide this differently, that we will be totally upending Article I judges, and everybody's going to end up being Article III judges, and we're going to require us to double the number of Article III judges in order to be able to handle this. And so there is a little bit of that consequentialism right up front. After that, it turns out to be a really fair fight over separation of powers, between a strong separation of powers, which is the view that the dissent took, and what we call a weak separation of powers that has quite a bit of quite a bit of precedent for it in the jurisprudence. So I don't think the decision is particularly out of line with our precedent, but it was but the court was clearly aware of the consequences of this decision.
There was a man in the hat who had a question. I sound like Cat in the Hat. All right, very well.
Let's see how we're doing on time, just a minute. We have 2 minutes, so go ahead. The Chevron thing was certainly a tour de force.
The question was whether anybody had noted the irony in King versus Burwell. The court decides not to defer under Chevron to the IRS, and yet in the prior case where the Chief Justice saved the ACA, the way that he saved it was by characterizing this as a tax. I think that we're actually talking about two different provisions. So what the court says here was that the IRS's regulations weren't, that the IRS was probably not the agency that they would have deferred to. I think under this particular provision of the Act, it might have been HHS. But HHS wasn't in charge of giving the tax exemption, and the court says we're not going to defer under Chevron to the IRS on this part of the Act that deals with the expertise of healthcare. So that's the way I read it, but it's a really interesting question.
One more. If there is one.
Back corner over there. I think it's Ed Chen.
I wouldn't try to speak to the causation question, but I think you're right. That was a very, very interesting reference in the opinion, and I have to believe that that's part of the reason why the court, or at least the majority of the court, thought that maintaining a disparate impact claim was significant, because the suggestion, the context I think in which that comment was made is that sure, we're always going to have a disparate treatment claim, which requires some showing of animus or intent, but we're not always able to smoke out, plaintiffs are not always able to prove that, and moreover, people can sometimes act not even conscious that what they're doing is based on race or religion or some other protected ground. So I think that's a very perceptive observation, and I do suspect that that's part of the reason why the court thought preserving a disparate impact claim was important.
Thank you very much.